when we gathered last Sunday with my family, the one that resonated or the one that got many mentions or when they shared, no, it's yung Let It Be. Diba? Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Speaking words of wisdom, let it be. You speak the word to that situation. Diba? Sabi ni Lord, actually, anda ano eh. Yes, it's correct, you speak to the Lord. But what he is actually saying, he's also saying, speak to the mountain.
Oh yeah.
Lumakas
yeah.
ka dyan. Diba? Yun sabi yeah. niya eh. Lies ka dyan, di ba? Ikaw, sakit ka dyan sa father-in-law ko, you have to go. Because that's yeah. illegal. That's illegal entry.
I speak with thanksgiving.
That is trespassing. Ganyan. So, amen. And the most, you know, holy thing that we can do is to agree with the Lord. Just like Mary, let it be done according to His word. So, kanina, I was very happy when I was listening to all of your sharings. You know, momentarily, kasi when you see with your eyeballs the situation, right, you panic, di ba? Kasi yun yung natural, ano. But then, hearing the word, just like yung sinishare kanina ni Ella na, no, hindi, makikinig ako talaga eh. Kasi it fortifies you eh. And it changes your mind, it changes your perspective. Now, instead of panic, having a grip on you, you have a grip on panic. Diba? You have a grip on fear. It cannot intimidate you. Right? Because the I am is in you. And together with the I am, all things will be possible. Yeah. Father, we thank you for your word. The entrance of your word gives light. The entrance of your word strengthens each and every part of our bodies. We declare your word to our situations, Lord. Lord, we say, let it be. Let it be. Let it be that your wholeness, Lord, is manifested. Let it be that your abundance is manifested each and every day, each and every moment of our lives, not only for us, but also to our families. You said, Lord, to the jailer in Acts, when Paul was speaking to him, he said, you and your household will be saved. And so we say, let it be in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So we continue to, study Psalms 91 verse 2. Yan. So the word now that we're going to study is the latter, no? I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him I will trust. Psalm 91 verse 2. So we've studied Amar, yung I will say. We studied Yudei Babe. We studied yung refuge. And then, ulitin ko lang yung Matsud, no? And then, now tonight is Elohim and I will trust. Hindi pa talaga natapos, Ella. Next week na yung in Him. Yeah. So yung Matsud, which is my fortress, my God, I will trust. So, ulitin natin yung fortress. Diba, sabi natin, it's good enough for God to be your refuge. But then, why is David mentioning fortress? So, in the Hebrew, when you click the interlinear, it's the Hebrew is matsud and it's a castle. So, the word fortress in Hebrew comes from the root word sur, which means to bind up, to press upon, to siege, to thrust forward, to advance. So, you have a picture of you having a grip on panic, di ba? Of you facing the enemy and saying, I tell you, go away and plant yourself in the deepest part of the Pacific Ocean. And yeah, and it's also the word for a neck and a rock. So, sabi natin last week, no? It is the small part of the ship is the rudder, which turns actually the entire boat. And what turns the head? It's the neck, right? Hallelujah. And some translations say, yung matsud or yung tsur is a word for stronghold or bulwark. Parang ano, no? The fort. Yan. New life, the fort. Parang ano, yung Fort Santiago. The context clearly indicates that God is a place of safety. Okay, so nirelate din natin yan dun sa Tower of Migdal Eder. Kasi alam natin na the Lord was born there in Luke 2, 7 and 8. And the Aramaic word for castle is Migdel, tower or a place of height or high honor. We know that in Migdal Eder, di ba? Migdal Eder is the place where the sacrificial lambs is taken care of. And then, the Lord, behold the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world, was born there. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So, now it talks about the Lord. The Lord being with you, your fortress. So you are able now to face the enemy and say to that enemy, go away, di ba? Or be gone or be destroyed in Jesus' name. Yeah, so the fields of Eder, which are just a few feet bordering Jerusalem, where the sacrificial rams were raised and cared for. The shepherds of these lambs were the elite shepherds of all the priestly tribe of Levi. They cared for the lambs so that they would remain without blemish or spot. And they watched the sheep 24 hours a day. From the birth of the lamb, they were spoiled rotten, wrapped in fine linen to remain without blemish and spot, and fed a special diet. So, this is a picture of a manger where the Lord Jesus was placed, and it just tells you that every day is we are actually to eat, right? The word of the Lord, who is our Lord Jesus Christ. Because the bread of life nourishes you, the bread of life saves you. Yeah. So a picture also that comes to mind when we are studying the word sur is David. So when we are facing Goliath, no, sabi niya. Sabi ni Goliath, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David. Come here, I'll give your flesh to the birds and the wild animals. Now David knew that the Lord was his refuge and his fortress. And so what did he do? David said to the Philistine, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, you enemy. You come against me with sickness over my relatives, but I come against you. I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, Shaddai, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day, today, not tomorrow. That's why salvation is for today. Today, right? Because hope deferred makes the heart sick. This day, the Lord will deliver you into my hands. I will struck you down and cut off your head. This very day, I will give your carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals. And the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. The whole of your relatives will know that there is a God, that your God is almighty and most powerful. And all those gathered here will know that it's not by sword or spear that the Lord saves. For the battle is the Lord's, and He will give all of you into our hands. No, it's a picture of you knowing that the Lord is your fortress. Now you can face the enemy. You know, you don't back down. You don't go into your room in panic, but you face the enemy head on. Hallelujah. So another one which will bless you. Teka lang, inom ako. Psalms 139, verse 5. David said, thou hast beset me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. So beautiful. You have beset me. You are my hedge before and after, before and behind, and laid your hand upon me. Yeah, sore, fortified. 139 verse 5. The word for beset, yan, naaral natin kanina, no? It's sur. As a noun, this is what Moses struck to get water from the rock. It is also used for fortress or fortified city. The word for behind is akor, which has the idea of behind or pass. And the word kedem means to go forward. That word ends with a close mem indicating the hidden or unknown, as is the future. Sometimes, no, we are afraid of the future. Hindi lang sometimes, often. right? Like, for example, you hear the news now, Israel is in war with Iran. Oh, what will happen? This expression, akor bakidem, expresses past and future. Thus, in my future, God sur besets me. In my past and in my future, God besets me before and after. The word sur is used as a verb here and is in kal perfect form. It is best expressed as, you entrench me or fortified me in my past and in my future. You have already fortified or entrenched me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sur. Hallelujah. So as David looked into the future, it looks pretty grim. There was a time in history that there was unrest in the history of David's kingship, that there was unrest in the nation. Indeed, one generation later, there would be a civil war in the land. There was the threat of the Assyrians. Parang ngayon, ano? Threat of the Syrians, di ba? Yung mga kamag-anak mga Iranians. And there was the threat to the very throne, as happened when his own son revolted si Absalom and sent David running from his kingdom with a price on his head. Day after day, David faced the mounting pressure of being a king and the terrors that were looking at him. Yet when David woke up in the morning facing the dread of what lay ahead, he was reminded, child of God, be reminded tonight that God has fortified you, entrenched you, or another expression for sure is you are hedged by him. The hedge or fortress was around him in the past, and it's around him in the present, and will continue to be around you in the future. Hallelujah. Because you are inscribed in the palm of his hands. You know, di ba, when you bless your children, you caress them in the palm of your hands, or you blow a kiss, right? You blow a kiss because the hand is actually a symbol of your heart. That's why, di ba, pag bayan magiliw, itaas ang kanang kamay, ilagay sa puso. Kasi magkadugtong siya eh. Then David said, you laid your hand upon me. The word laid is tashet, is actually in a future tense and means to place or set. You will set me in your yapap. Yapap is the palm of the hand. Yapap. The verse literally says, you have set me in the palm of your hand. We are sheltered in the hollow of his hand. But remember, during ancient times, it is believed that one's heart was in the palm of the hand. Hallelujah. So, meaning you are in the heart of Abba, always and forever. Thus, David was saying that he will not fear or live in dread of the future, for he is sheltered in the heart of God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Okay. Now, in Genesis 1:26, and God, Elohim, di ba? My God, in Him I will trust. The word God there is Elohim. Elohim is Father, Son, and Spirit. He said, let us make man in our image and according to our likeness so that they will have dominion. You have dominion over all things. This was God's declaration about mankind's nature and destiny. Mankind was created as image and likeness of Father, Son, and Spirit with full dominion over all things, and then placed in a finished and completely prepared environment in the Garden of Eden, diba? And included in intimate face-to-face relationship with Father, Son, and Spirit in indivisible union forever with them. And then Elohim, God, Father, Son, and Spirit saw their beautiful mankind and said, very good. When he saw you, he said, very good. Good is tov in Hebrew. It means functioning as designed. You are good. You are functioning in your original design, completely enclosed in and surrounded with grace, beauty, love, health, prosperity, whole and complete. Let it be done according to your word, Abba. Hallelujah, hallelujah. This is what God saw. Ido, behold, vivid emotions expressed and declared. And it's still what God sees and declares over you, regardless of your circumstances. But from Adam's fall to the present day, we walk far below the abundant life that God designed for us to walk in. Because our perception is distorted, We have been taught to see life and ourselves through our circumstances, through others' opinions, and through our wrong understanding of who God is and how He sees us. Adam fell in his understanding of God's identity and his own identity. As God's image and likeness, designed to rule and reign on earth, and mankind after him continued to fall farther and farther in that understanding, they have forgotten who they were and who God was in Deuteronomy 32:18. You forgot the rock who fathered you and forgot the God who gave you birth. Deuteronomy says mankind was unmindful and had forgotten. What were they unmindful of? What did they forget? And we also tend to forget that they were sons in the image and likeness of God with dominion over all things, placed in a finished and completely prepared environment and included in intimate face-to-face relationship with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in indivisible union forever with them. The mere Bible says it this way: you have forgotten the rock that begot you and have gotten out of step with the God who danced with you. The Mechanical Translation Bible, a Hebrew translation, uses the word twist for chul, which our English Bible translates gave birth. Chul means writhe, twist, whirl, and dance. The Mechanical Translation saying it's a twisting together. To wrap, no, Elohim ng galing, no? To wrap separate pieces together, forming one unit, a wrapping or winding together entwined, intimate union face to face. They were unmindful of this. They forgot they were in an indivisible union with God. They saw themselves as separated from God. They were unmindful of this. They forgot they were indivisible with God. Colossians 1:21 says that mankind was once alienated and hostile or adversaries in their minds. Praise the Lord. In Philippians 2:15, your flawless innocence radiates attraction as beacons of light in the midst of people who have forgotten their true sonship and whose lives have become distorted and perverse. So, child of God, it is your awareness that you have Abba, that you have the Son and the Holy Spirit in you, that you are a son, you are a daughter. But God has not forgotten, he said, I have declared the end from the beginning. I have declared the end from the beginning. Our beginning is not based on what Adam declared from the fall. It is based only on what God declared in the beginning before creation. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And what is that? Finish, complete. Okay, now we go to my God, in Him I will trust. Ulit. Ang init kasi. Kailangan uminom. Praise the Lord. So, this is a word that has been revealed to us several times, but the Lord wants to repeat again. Betak. Welded to God. You are welded to God. You are welded to Elohim. The word trust in Hebrew is batak, betak, which means to weld. That is when you are weld two pieces of metal together, the metal melts into each other. So to trust God is to melt yourself into Him. Archaeologists have discovered evidence of welding in the Middle East that predates this verse. Welding is securing two pieces of metal together. A perfect weld will be so secure that you could break that piece of metal that in any other place before you break it at the weld. A weld will literally melt two pieces of metal into each other. But there's another meaning to the word. In Proverbs 3, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not in your own understanding. It also means watermelon, right? What does a watermelon have to do with trusting? For ancient man traveling through the desert, watermelon was a natural container to carry water as an emergency water supply. The steady stream of God's word, when you understand it with all of your heart, makes you fortified. Hallelujah. Okay, another one. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. This is Havdalah. it is the candle. It is a candle which is a very common wedding gift among the Hebrews, among the Jews. It is two rope. It is two rope like candles braided together. And as they burn the wax, it melts into each other, becoming one. It is the symbol of marriage where two gradually grow into each other until they become one. In Isaiah 62 verse 5, as a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so will your God. The word in Hebrew for bridegroom is katan, which is also the word for marriage. In its Semitic root, it has the idea of being joined together in complete truth and honesty. The word bride is kala, which has a double meaning, destruction and completion. When you are married to God as a bride to a bridegroom, your old life is destroyed. No longer it is a life devoted to just yourself. No longer it is the defeated life, but now it is the resurrected life. But you live to bring pleasure to another person. So too in our marriage to God, we live to receive from Him His pleasure. Because grace is not a gift. Grace is not a gift God gives you so you can continue living by yourself, married to Him who was raised from the dead. Hallelujah. You know, there's another facet to this. Di ba yung during weddings, and I think this is very common among Americans, and it's catching up among Filipinos, no? Some translations say rejoice always rejoice, or rejoice at all times. Diba? Rejoice, I say rejoice. There is one word in this verse, the word kaba, which not always translated. Kaba is the word be, which is in an imperative form command. We are always to be in a state of joy. And the word for joy is kadin, which is an active participle, and it's something we are supposed to be continually doing. In the Greek, the word rejoice is kairet, which simply means to be glad. However, Paul's language was Aramaic, di ba? Hindi naman Greek. The word used in the Aramaic Bible is much more expressive of the type of joy he's talking about. It is the word kada, which does not mean a bridal dance, but the joy of the bridal dance. You never hear a groom dance, right? Even today. In ancient times, the bride was the center of attraction. Even today, the ancients even had a word for the joy of this dance, kada. This is the joy that the Apostle Paul is declaring we should have. This is the joy of our salvation, our wedding, our marriage to God, which will be a marriage for all eternity. And God wants to show us off, right? His glory, right? It's because He's so proud of us, and we rejoice or kada over our groom, Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And which brings me to John 14, 15, 18. Remember the story of the Samaritan woman? Sabi ni Lord, go and get your husband. And sabi niya, I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said, you have well said, I have not husband, for you have had five husbands, and the man you are with is not your husband. So when you are just reading this superficially, parang, okay, lima yung asawa niya. But you know what? A little cultural backstory here. Jesus had just turned his discussion with this woman to a powerful spiritual lesson concerning the living waters, the word of God. Culturally, a Samaritan woman was not allowed to discuss spiritual things with a man other than her husband, which is why Jesus told her to get her husband. Oh, di ba? Kaya nga sabi ni Lord, go get your husband so that we can discuss. Secondly, a Samaritan woman had to be under the domain of a man. Otherwise, she was considered a prostitute. Hence, there was a lot of horse trading going on among men with their wives, or should we say wife trading. A man had no choice but to take an unmarried woman into his home if she did not have a husband. So ganun yung nangyari sa kanya, no? After a while, if the man got tired of the woman, he would have to find another man willing to take her off his hand. So hindi naman sinabi na prostitute siya, di ba? So pinagpasapasahan siya because the culture of that day, ganon. That might make a little rough if the poor woman had some disability or was not one of the hot women. Sometimes the husband would have to throw in an ox or a donkey as a part of the deal to take a wife off his hand. Such a husband who enters a marriage of convenience is often very unloving and in fact treats the wife as a slave who would beat and torment the wife emotionally and get away with it. Samaria was truly a man's world. Such a husband was called in the Aramaic Baal, an evil or abusive husband. Did you know that in the conversation, Jesus called the husband Baal? This is exactly the Aramaic word that Jesus used when he told the woman to get her husband. That is her Baal, abusive husband. She responded by saying she did not have an abusive husband. Jesus said she was right. Because the man she was married to, because culturally she had to be married, was not a Baal. He was in fact an Ishi. An Ishi. Yan. A loving, caring husband who respected her and was good to her. So the point is, after being passed around by five different men, she landed on her feet with a good man, a loving, caring, tender-hearted man who really loved her. Her dream to have someone who really cared for her was not abusive. How often she must have prayed for to God for a caring man in her life. How often she felt that if she had such a husband, an issue, she would be satisfied. Then she met the Lord, right? She met the Lord. Yet Jesus knew something. He knew he knew her heart and knew even though she got what she wanted, even if she was the envy of many other Samaritan women, she was not satisfied. She still had an emptiness, a longing in her heart. Jesus told her that longing could not be satisfied with a man, with a perfect husband, for what she craved. Her husband, no man could give her, and only the living water, right, can satisfy her. Can that, no, only our awareness of our union with the Lord can satisfy us. Hallelujah. Can that, no? So finally, kasi yung topic natin na welded to God, no? So nandito na naman tayo sa union. Anyway, Hosea 2:19. You know, this is so precious. When I read this, I was like, oh man, thank you, Abba. I will betroth thee unto me. For how long? Forever. Forever. Yeah, inulit na naman. I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness and in judgment and in loving kindness and in mercies. Isa-isahin natin, ano? So what is betrothal? The word in Hebrew is aras. Yeah, naaral natin ito before. The word itself, aras, comes from a Semitic root found in the Sumerian language, which means to desire. Hence, the whole idea behind a betrothal is to build a desire between a man and a woman. So there was a teaching that when a male child is born, his soul was split into two, and the other half of his soul would be placed by God into a female child who would one day be born. God would anoint a shidduch or matchmaker who would have a prophetic gift to determine the young woman or the other half of the soul. Kaya nga may term na soulmate. Yun. Often, this determination was made between two individuals who had never met each other. It was understood that there must be a period of time for these two to learn to love each other before the marriage was consummated. Thus, we have the time of betrothal. This is where the idea of engagement originated. This whole idea of an engagement and an engagement ring has its roots in Judaism. This is a Jewish concept, as God is giving us a picture of our relationship to Him, as our relationship with our bridegroom. Diba? Eternal life is knowing Him. Eternal life is knowing Him. Knowing Him intimately. So, Hosea 2:14-23, therefore, behold, I will allure her, that's you, and bring her into wilderness. Actually, that wilderness in Hebrew is pasture, and speak comfortably, intimately unto her. I will give her vineyards from thence, and the valley of Achor For the door of hope, the valley of trouble will be turned into a valley of hope. Confident expectation, Jesus. And she shall sing. Ayan, in the valley of Achor, you sing. There, as in the days of her youth, pure and without spot or blemish. You are the righteousness of God in Christ. And as in the day when she came up out of the land of Egypt. Egypt means siege, enclosure, or bondage of works. The finished work of Christ freed us from this state. And it shall be at that day, says the Lord. Rather, Yahweh, our Father God. And thou shalt call me Ishi. Ishi. Man in flesh, our husband, our bridegroom, Jesus. And thou shalt call me no more Baali. Baali means Lord, the name of an idol with whom you cannot have any relationship. For I will take away the names of Baalim, useless idols, out of your mouth, the one she worships, and they shall no more be remembered by their name. Because yung Baali, kanina naaral natin, di ba, abusive. And in that day, I will make a covenant for them with the beast of the field and with the fowls of the heaven and with the creeping things of the ground. Nothing will ever hurt you again. Death will be overcome. And I will break the bow and the sword of the battle of the earth. No more death, sorrow, pain, and hardship ever. And I will make them to lie down safely in his glorious rest. And I will betroth thee unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness, in judgment. Judgment is you've been made the righteousness of God in Christ. All the judgment that you're supposed to get was poured on the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. And in loving kindness, the very character of God, and in mercy's deep compassion, I will betroth thee unto me in faithfulness, new faith, the faith of the Lord Jesus, trust his name, Jesus. And thou shalt know, have intimacy with the Lord, Yahweh, Yudhe Babe. And it shall come to pass in that day, I will hear, you will hear, you will respond to Yahweh on the cross, says the Lord. I will hear the heavens, and they shall hear the earth. Heaven and earth shall kiss. And the earth shall hear the corn and the wine and the oil, the fullness of the Godhead, Jesus, talking about communion, right? His body, blood, and spirit. And they shall hear Jezreel. It means the one Yahweh sowed himself in human flesh. And I will sow her unto me in the earth. It's the story of Jesus. And I will have mercy, deep love, and compassion upon her that has not obtained mercy, accused of being a sinner. And I will say to them which were not my people, kinsmen, you are my people. You are my kinsmen. And they shall say, you are my God. Hallelujah. So, my dear brother, and my dear sisters, I will say of the Lord, you are my refuge, my God, in him will I trust. You are welded forever to the Lord. You are betrothed forever to the Lord. I will betroth you unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth you unto me in righteousness and in judgment and in loving kindness and in mercies. And that, my dear brother and sisters, is chapter 2, part 3. Praise the Lord.
Elements. Okay. Father God, Abba Father, thank you so much for giving us all the rights of claiming the authority looking up to you and speaking your name, Yahweh, speaking your name and calling you our Father, claiming you as our Father, Daddy God. Thank you for that kind of privilege. You have given this privilege to us because of the gift that you have given us, and that is your most precious Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father God, for the body of Jesus Christ that had been scourged on the cross. By his stripes, we are healed because of what he did on the cross. And because of this,
amen,
our bodies, from the crowns of our heads to the heels, to the toes of our feet, Father, we grant and we proclaim healing upon us, our bodies. No more tumors, no more cancers, no illness, no minor sicknesses. Everything had been put away. Thank you, Father God, as we partake. Amen. We thank you, Father God, for the gift of righteousness, claiming all the victory through your Son, Jesus Christ. The blood that He have poured over us, that cleansed us, purified us from the sins, condemnation, from curse, Father, from all these negative things. We do not look outwardly anymore. We do not look at earthly things anymore, Father, but we fix our eyes on Jesus. Thank you so much, Father. Thank you so much for the blood of Jesus Christ. We truly are purified, whiter as snow, and we are healed. We are sinless, and we are righteous. Righteousness. We're claiming righteousness as we partake.